My name is Ilya Benish, and I'm a building analyst with the Cold Climate Housing Research Center here in Fairbanks, Alaska, Climate Zone 8. And in this video, we're going to discuss the topic of ice dams. But particularly, we are interested in ice dams and how they form in rafter-framed roofs with cathedral ceilings, because these are very common here in the state of Alaska. And unfortunately, if a roof like this isn't built correctly, heat losses can cause the snow to melt on that roof, and then that meltwater flows down and forms an ice layer along the eaves. In this video, we're going to look at a home that's about 25 years old. It's had a history of severe ice dams, and we're going to try to figure out what the root cause of those ice dams is. We're going to start with an exterior inspection and then move to the inside, where we're going to conduct some air leakage testing with a blower door and an infrared camera scan. And then ultimately, hopefully, we can remove some of the soffit on the exterior of the building and get a look inside. Our first step in our inspection of the exterior is to get a look at the actual ice dam. And this particular ice dam is a big one in that it extends the width of the heated portion of the house along the eaves on both sides. And ice dams form due to heat losses through the roof assembly, warming up the roof deck, warming up the shingles or the roof metal to the point where the snow contacting that roof metal or the roof shingles thaws, and then it runs down the roof until it goes over the soffit area here, which are still nice and cold, and so that melt water gets out here to the soffits, which are the outdoor temperatures, and then it refreezes. And this freezing process of melt water happens all winter long, and if you're particularly unlucky, you end up with an ice dam like this. Due to severe heat losses, it's starting to pull the gutters off. And there are typically three conditions that will cause an ice dam, and it's rare that it's just one by itself. Usually it's a combination of the three. The first one is air leakage. That means we have holes in the ceiling indoors and warm air is escaping and going up into our rafter bay and warming up our roof deck. The second condition is insufficient insulation. Either the insulation was installed poorly, or there simply wasn't enough insulation, and so there's conductive heat losses that are going through this roof assembly and warming the roof deck. The third condition is inadequate ventilation. And so with a rafter bay roof like this, we are counting on at least 1.5 inches continuous airspace in every rafter bay to draw cold air in through our soffit vents, run along the underside of our roof sheathing, and exit up there at the ridge. That keeps the roof plywood cold and keeps everything above the plywood frozen. If for any reason those vents are plugged or they're not moving enough air, that will also contribute to that heat buildup in this roof assembly and back to the ice dam problem. In this case, there's something else unusual I'd like to point out to, and that is this icicle here. It's actually one of many. And when I initially looked at this home a month ago, we had a period of warm weather a few days after my inspection. But a month ago, these icicles weren't here. And this icicle is coming right out of the soffit vent. And in this case, my theory is that all winter long, there's been air leakage up into this ceiling, and that air leakage has been transporting water vapor, which has then been condensing and freezing inside the rafter bays. And suddenly we had an unseasonably warm day. It was 40 degrees, and all that ice that was building up inside the roof suddenly thawed, melted, and ran down over the wall and came out of this soffit vent. I'm now about 3/4 of the way up the roof, and I've dug an exploratory hole here in the snow, and I've encountered ice right on top of the shingles. And even up here, there's heat losses through this roof system that are great enough that we're seeing evidence of melting and icing. And keep in mind, this snow is about 2 feet thick, and snow insulates with an R value of about 1 to 2 per inch. And so in that sense, we've got a nice thick insulation layer here that's trapping those heat losses right on top of the shingles for long enough that we're starting to see the melting and evidence of icing here. I'm now at the top of the roof, and I'm at one end. And what's really interesting here is all of the snow
at the ridge cap here is melted away until I get to the overhang, which is uninsulated, and then I've got basically undisturbed snow. And so one of the reasons I go up on these ridges to check and see if the roof is vented, because sometimes they get reshingled, and for whatever reason, the guys shingling the roof don't put the vents back. And that can also contribute to ice dam. So anytime you do an inspection like this, make sure that the roof is vented at the top. In this case, what I think is going on here is that indoor air is leaking into this roof assembly from below, and that air is traveling along and exiting here through the vents because it's melted the snow along the entire length of this ridge, but it's just limited to the ridge vent itself.
We are now turning our attention to the inside of the home. And this part of our investigation starts with a visual inspection. We're going to take a look at the home and the ceiling in particular, and we're looking for any visual anomalies or clues that might indicate either insufficient insulation or air leakage pathways that are contributing to the ice damming outside. After we've conducted our visual inspection, then we're going to engage in a blower door test in combination with an infrared camera scan, and that should highlight, if they exist, any obvious air leakage pathways in the ceiling. The first thing that I noticed immediately upon walking into the living space is my glasses fogged up completely. And then once I wipe my glasses off, I could see on these double pane windows that there's a lot of condensation down around along the bottom. Today it's a 15 degree Fahrenheit day. It's pretty warm outside. And so I already have some really good indicators that this home is underventilated and that the humidity levels have been high in here all winter long. What that means in terms of this roof is that all that water vapor in wintertime can get transported via air leakage up inside this roof assembly. And then on a day like today where it's nice and warm, all that frost buildup that's in the roof in wintertime is thawing and running out our soffit vents and forming those icicles that we saw outside. What we have in this home is a tongue and groove paneled ceiling. And these are really popular in Alaska, and especially so with log places. And one problematic area involving air leakage is if these tongue and groove panels aren't sealed where they rest on the exterior walls, on these eave walls. Remember, we're in the positive pressure zone up here at ceiling level. So in wintertime, all of our hot, moisture-laden indoor air is going to try to exfiltrate out of all of these little holes where the panels meet. And I can look here and I can see water staining that travels 5 or 6 inches up inside this groove. That's telling me that indoor air is getting up into this roof assembly. That means there's potentially some heat losses contributing to the ice dams that are directly on the other side of this paneling. And the moisture in that air is condensing, and then during warm periods like today, the moisture that's in the roof thaws and then runs back down and causes this water staining. So we have another strong indication that there's some air leakage occurring into this roof assembly. At this point, I've looked at the entire tongue and groove ceiling in the house, and what I've determined is the paneling was put up continuously before any of these walls were framed. And all of the wiring is surface mounted. So areas that would typically produce air leakage would be if this wall had been built first and the paneling was pieced around it. But our ceiling is actually remarkably continuous. At the same time, we've got ice dams on both sides of this roof that stretch across the entire house. So something is going on, but we don't have any localized areas of air leakage. We've got a bigger problem here. One other interesting thing I've noticed with this roof is that out here in the field, none of this paneling has been nailed. It's only been fastened over the wall and then 12 feet up on the ridge log. Everything here in the middle has no nails in it. And so over the years, this paneling has shrunk and moved, and I can actually see a gap between these two boards, and the vapor retarder is directly behind this paneling. So one more piece of information we have is that there is indeed a vapor retarder present. And so the next step is going to be to conduct an air leakage test to see if there's any obvious places where this vapor retarder is either missing or not sealed properly.
Oh.
I've got our blower door calibrated fan hooked up now. It's in this open doorway. And this fan will produce a suction on this home and evacuate the air out of the home to an equivalent of about a 14 mile an hour wind. So as this fan is sucking the warm air out of the home, all that evacuated air is getting replaced by cold air getting pulled in through air leakage points. I'll be using this infrared camera and I'll be scanning the ceiling, and any place we have air leakage points, in theory, they should get very cold and I should be able to pinpoint those spots with the camera. So even though I can't see the spot necessarily, I can find the area where the air leakage is occurring. We've been running our fan for a little over 10 minutes now, and that's long enough for all that outdoor air that's getting pulled in through the air leakage points to super cool the spots where it's getting drawn in. And I've been scanning this ceiling with my camera, and by far the most obvious areas of air leakage are all the way along the eave walls at every single tongue and groove panel joint. And what that's telling me is that the vapor retarder on the other side of that paneling is either non-existent or poorly sealed. I'm also getting some cold spots out here in the field. They're not as dramatic as the eave walls, but they could indicate that there's places where the vapor retarder overlaps aren't sealed properly. And there is a roof redo scheduled this summer, and that will determine whether there's also problems with the vapor retarder overlaps. But for sure, we've got some real problems over these eave walls. So now let's go outside and take a look and open up the soffits and see what we can see over those eave walls from the outside looking in. Surprise, surprise. Somebody before us knew that this was a problem area. We've now removed one of our soffit boards and one piece of blocking between the rafter bays, and we're learning a lot more as we go along here. First issue I'm seeing is, yes, I see caulking where the tongue and groove paneling was caulked to the top of the log here, but all of the tongue and groove ends extend all the way to the outside of this log wall, and each one of these ends is exposed. And that's why we saw during our air leakage test the ability to draw cold air in. So when you're not running a blower door and the house is operating under normal conditions, yes, indoor air is escaping through each one of these leaky butt joints in our tongue and groove boards and getting up into this rafter bay, into every rafter bay, and traveling up that rafter bay and contributing to warming that roof deck and leading to the ice dams. This is strange. I'm seeing evidence by reaching all the way up here. I'm seeing evidence that this was added later. And so this kind of supports the rumor that this home back, 15 years ago had some serious roof work done, because somebody has added fiberglass bats wrapped in black plastic. Remember, when I was inside, I could look through the joints in the tongue and groove and I could see a clear plastic vapor retarder. This here, I don't know what the logic behind it was, but it's kind of a red herring. It's not really doing anything, at least anything good. But what this work has done is whoever put this in didn't pay any attention to keeping the vent space open. So the fiberglass is completely jammed up against the roof plywood. And remember, our ridge vent appears to be working very, very well. But where's all that air that's coming out the ridge vent coming from? Well, like we thought earlier, that air is indeed warm air that's getting pulled through all the holes in our tongue and groove, because in order for that air to come out the ridge, the replacement air has to come from somewhere else. In a properly designed roof, you will have a balanced ventilation system, and your soffit vents and your vent space here will be designed so they provide at least as much air as the ridge needs to ventilate properly. If you don't do that, you're simply accelerating the air leakage through the ceiling and contributing to the moisture loading inside this roof system. to repair this now, you're going to have to remove the roof completely and re-insulate, ensure you have a vent space, and make sure the air sealing is done well. This concludes our investigation. We've gone as far as we can. And unfortunately, with rafter-framed roofs like this, you pretty much have to do it right the first time. If you don't get them right the first time, you get vulnerabilities like this with air leakage and ice dams. And the solution is often to replace the roof, either from the inside or the outside. And in this case, this roof is scheduled to be replaced this summer. It will give us an opportunity, hopefully, to come back here and document this roof in its entirety from above. And maybe we can identify some more air leakage points that we weren't able to pinpoint with the IR camera. But it's clear our main culprit for now is right here along the eaves. And in our video description, we will provide additional links to information on how to design and build a rafter-framed cathedral roof like this that works in Climate Zone 8. And as always, we welcome your questions and comments. My name is Ilya Benesh. Hi there.